my guest is Dr. DeLay from MIT. He's recognized for his foundational contributions to robust control theory, computational methods for controller design, the interplay between information and control, the fundamental limits of learning and decision in network systems, and the detection and mitigation of systematic risk in interconnected and networked systems. Welcome to our show today.
Thank you.
So all your work is mostly on large network systems, which affect a lot of different areas of our lives. Everything from power grids to the internet to air travel. As these increase, how is this affecting us in different ways? How is it affecting security? What kind of risks are being developed?
Right. So things are getting more and more complicated, right? With the Internet of Things, networks are instrumented, there's a lot of local actuation, controls, and communication between these components. So there's a lot of room for hacking them, or for misinformation that may propagate and cascade into different phenomena. The complexity is added because of the heterogeneous aspect of these networks. So we've got cyber-like network where sensors and actuators are talking to each other through a communication link. We have a physical network on the ground, you know, transportation network, or car grid, electricity moving around, and people moving around. They have their own dynamics. But then also there's an added component of people engaged in these systems. Us, you know, we make decisions, we decide to do certain things, and based on our decision, things happen. So if you think about a transportation system, it's not just the highways and the streets, it's also the decisions that drivers make. And the way that these decisions are made during congestion or during difficult times, right? And so to be able to model all of this interaction, analyze it, and mitigate risk and figure out, it's basically becoming a more interesting problem. Of course, it's kind of nice for us as researchers because it gives us more opportunities to be more interested in new research.
You mentioned the complexity between human decisions and smart decisions, or decisions that are coming from IoT. How does this complexity kind of interplay? Because things are becoming more and more integrated, things are becoming more and more smart operator, sensor operator, but there is, like you said, there is still a human element. How are things changing?
The IoT is enabling the human component, right? So all of us move around with our smartphones. We look at the state of the system, whether it's a transportation system or the stock market, right? And then we're able to engage that system through our actions. So the IoT is enabling us. Now the question is, how's our decision made? Well, there's some information that comes to us, and we base our decisions based on the information that we get. So depending on how accurate the information is, and our sentiments, because we're people, and we are subject to manipulation, we make different kinds of decisions. So just because we have the IoT is clearly an enabler, but it doesn't impact how we make our decisions. So other mechanisms have to be in place to help us make our decisions, either recommendations or incentives through pricing. If you think about the move towards real-time demand response for the power grid. Why? Because we want to eliminate excess energy consumption. So we would like to incentivize people to think about how they're using electricity. How do you do that? If I told you, why don't you just lower the level of air conditioning in your home because that helps the population, you may or may not do it. But if I, for example, somewhere outside of Saudi Arabia, for example, elsewhere where energy is very expensive, I tell you that you can save 10% in your bill by letting me control your thermostat, you may like that. And so I have to understand your situation, and I have to make you an offer that will make you participate. And that aspect of what we call that mechanism design, it's about incentivizing proper behavior and collectively getting everybody participating in that. It's a lot more complicated than controlling something on the ground and saying, oh, I can change this because I have total control. So the interplay is very interesting, and just we're beginning to understand how to do it well. You know, but certainly Internet of Things is enabling things, and it's Hallelujah, we can't escape it. I mean, definitely right now, if you think about transportation systems in places like Singapore, you know, they're very advanced because they utilize the sense of information, the measure of information. So they have automated toll system, right? So the pricing of certain highways is a function of congestion. They have real time lane assignments, so the capacity of the road changes depending on the real time. So sometimes the lanes are given to opposite traffic. They control the traffic lights and real time based on traffic. And traffic is controlled by decisions from people. And then as a result, people respond to the incentives. Maybe in this particular case, how much they have to pay for the street. This is all happening and it's running in real time. And you know, there have been some hacks where people understood exactly where the bottleneck is, hacked the traffic lines and cause major congestions for several hours. And now we have to understand how to prevent that kind of happening from coming into town. So it's happening very rapidly.
That's amazing. So it sounds like when you're first describing this, like a utopia, man and machine kind of working together, but then you have these hackers or these things that happen that cause something, a risk within the system. As they become more and more integrated with
yeah, I mean, there's a sort of a conservation law, so to speak, right? You can robustify the system in certain ways, but then it becomes vulnerable in different ways. So there's unintended consequences. You do something, and then it has an end. And we're constantly in the problem trying to figure out, you know, by improving our designs in a certain way, do we create vulnerability elsewhere? And we're always, as researchers, thinking about how these things work. I don't think we'll ever be safe 100%, that's not possible. And only even prove a folklore theorem that says that every system, every interconnection has vulnerability. Every interconnection has vulnerability. The only issue is how do you transform the system to a safe mode once you detect that vulnerability. And I think that's where, you know, we try to minimize these kind of fragility in the system, but then when we detect it, how do we, you know, we figure out how to mitigate them and how to transition the system to a safe mode. So things are emerging all the time, new things are happening, and as devices come into our homes and the complexity of all of this is rising, as a result, I think the possibilities for either intrusion, hacking, or just natural unintended consequences that cascade are going to increase.
And that leads me to the next question. We often talk about hacking, but there are a number of different types of vulnerabilities that can happen to the network system. Talk about some of these.
Well, obviously, in the context of a power grid, for example, many of the things that we faced in the past in terms of outages are not hacks, they're a consequence of a weather phenomenon. And things are fairly simple, like a tree falls on a distribution line, raised distribution line, increasing the load elsewhere, that cascades into a bunch of failures. And, you know, the 2003 blackout in New England was actually caused by a tree that fell because of a thunderstorm. So it's not a hack, it's not malicious, it has a low probability of happening, it's not something that happens every day, but it can happen. So, and in general, the more you optimize a system and you try to get the maximum performance out of that system, it becomes more vulnerable to these kinds of things. That's one thing that robust control theory that we have people that work on, try to capture these types of trade-offs.
How can you balance that between what would be the most optimal you could be without it being vulnerable? How is the trade-off?
There's a trade-off. Sometimes you have to step away a little bit from vulnerability, create some slack. Step away from performance, from optimality, create some slack in the system so that we can accommodate a little bit of error problems that can occur. You have to figure out how to do that design, how to do these trade-offs. A lot of the theory that's developed about designing systems, if you try to design a control system for an airplane, a control system for a cargo and so forth, is doing that trade-off and quantifying it. That's, you know, people don't really pay attention to a lot of that work, but that's really what goes in the background, is that we understand that we know so much about the system, but there are things that we don't know. And the things that we don't know can be dangerous, because if it kicks in, we have a model, we don't know how it's going to behave. So we anticipate that something may happen, and we robustify for that. So as a result, we cannot get the best out of the system, but we get fairly good performance. So the trade-off and the quantification of the trade-off is what theory does for us. It gives us that kind of fundamental limit. If you want to be robust of a certain kind of perturbations in the system, you can get so much performance out of that system. And then we design it to meet that kind of performance. It's quite a bit involved theory, and it's several decades of research that's gone into quantifying these types of trade-offs, and there's a lot of domain expertise understanding different applications and what these trade-offs look at these different applications. So it's not an off-the-shelf type thing that you do.
As we get more and more network in our world, are there certain industries that are certain networks that are becoming more vulnerable or that we need to start paying attention to? We hear of the stock market is vulnerable, power grids are vulnerable, but these are ones that we know have been vulnerable for years and years. Are there new things that are coming onto your radar where you're thinking this one could be a risk?
Almost any network. I mean, right now, for example, new things are emerging in social media. Social media is a big network. Facebook, right? You've got followers, and you've got friends, and friends, and that defines a network. How does the vulnerability show itself? Facebook, who cares, right? Well, it's creating the media bubbles, right? And there's evidence that we've actually done that kind of research to show that many people are getting their news from Facebook. How do they get it? They either get the fake news or whatever news that is advertised to them, but also they see what their friends post. And you see what I post and you post, and we. But that is a bubble, because my friends were selected because of a reason, right? They're kind of people that think like me. And now they post articles and news in a certain way that they think is relevant and important, but that's the kind of stuff I like to hear, and that's the news I read, and all of a sudden I am living in a bubble. And that bubble is a vulnerability of that particular social network, right? It doesn't have enough diversity. Now the news is available elsewhere, but this behavior of living within my network causes this part of that vulnerability. And it's not a trivial matter, right? I mean, the fact that we have thought that, the expression of democratization of information now, we thought that we can access information anywhere in the world. I can get the news from any country in the world. Isn't really happening. People are not getting the information from anywhere in the world. They're not learning about every country. They're living in their own bubbles. It's a consequence of some of the vulnerability in social media. It's self-inflicted. Right? Self-inflicted is part of the social behavior. So that's a network which is not, people don't talk about vulnerability there because they're not worried about hacking and destroying the software, but it is causing a change in the way people think.
I was reading some research that you've been doing on the herding phenomenon that comes from this. Can you explain that a little bit?
Sure, yeah. So I think that it's a very simple idea, right? That you're trying to select a restaurant, and you're walking around in downtown, in a downtown city, and then you're looking at the restaurant, and then you pick the one that has the more people in it. Why you feel like, okay, more people are going there, it must be providing good food. And all of a sudden, after a couple of people join one restaurant, everybody's going to that restaurant. But it doesn't mean that it's the better restaurant, right? That's herding. That's a behavior that we engage all the time. And our analysis is trying to understand, when do we herd and when do we not herd? How much additional information do I need to have, extra independent information, to make me not follow the crowd and say, no, actually, this Italian restaurant over here is actually better than this Chinese restaurant that has twice or three times the number of people. So we try to understand this kind of, how do I get out of this behavior, and what sort of information causes people to have this behavior. So it's a phenomenon that we see all the time, and we try to understand the underlying networks that cause it.
Especially as social media is becoming more curated, so if you do like a certain thing, they keep sending you the same thing more and more. So your bubble's getting smaller and smaller and smaller.
Yeah.
So how can that be prevented? Is it people have to go and find new friends, or should it be?
Yeah, that's a really interesting question. I don't have an answer to that. I mean, what is the platform that would allow this diversification? You know, despite people's behavior. We start saying, well, we will send you random news anyway, which we do. It's about 10-15% of Facebook news is random, selected random news. Would that even change this public behavior? It hasn't. 50% has not. But if you start sending me 50% diversification news, it may bother me because you're sending too much information I haven't asked for. So I don't know what the right platform is to get us out of the bubble.
Can the herding phenomenon be positive?
Yeah, of course. I mean, if you think about recycling, it's a herding phenomenon. No one I know knows what happens to the recycling of that stuff. You know, you heard that this is good for the environment. Your neighbors do it, you do it. We follow them. I mean, there was a time in the United States that nobody recycled. And then this phenomenon stopped it. And then everybody started following, and then it became an important thing. I recycle, I don't know what happens to it, but I believe it's the right thing to do. So it's very positive. It's shown that, for example, people quit smoking, I don't know, people in their family or friends quit smoking. That's a herding phenomenon. They don't do it because they recognize that stopping to smoke is the right thing to do. It's just something that happens when your friends stop smoking. That's another positive thing that can happen. So herding is not always a bad thing, often a good thing. But you need to understand when it happens and when it happens in the wrong way. Another herding that is bad for us, of course, you mentioned the stock market and the hacking of the stock market. But herding in the stock market is actually an important phenomenon, which is not very good. And that is when either people buy a certain stock and feel that this is actually doing very well, they more and more people start buying, which actually inflates the price of that particular stock more than what its value. That's one direction. And the other direction is if you get a signal that maybe the stock market is not doing well, you sell, and then I see that you sell, I sell, and then we cause an actual collapse in the market. So that's a self-fulfilling type behavior, which is also coming from herding. So you get the two sides of it. Well, the notions are different. Every network you have, you have to understand what the network's trying to do, what's being communicated, is it observations, is it decisions, and so forth. So every network we look at its nature and what it means for something to be resilient. In political and social networks, we talk a lot about consensus. You know, and consensus is when, for example, opinion dynamics converge. All of our opinions agree on a particular candidate to vote on, or half the population, or more than half the population. We don't talk about consensus often in the electoral grid. That's not a notion that we worry about. So different networks, different applications for the network, we think about different kinds of notions.
Can you see where the social networks could possibly fail
First of all, I think social networks are here to stay because it's something that is organically design, right? You know, we were connecting with friends, and now we have media to connect with broader sectors. So I, you know, so I think that we cannot really control how social networks emerge. I see their impacts more on, you know, sociological and maybe psychological than something worse than all of a sudden something is not working. You know, maybe the impacts on younger kids and how they view education, how they view sports, and how they view relationships with others has a longer term impact, being in the part of these social networks and social networks going in the direction that you don't want them to. I don't see it as, maybe I'm missing some good examples, but on the fly, I don't see it as something where, if it works, we have a collapse in the financial system. I mean, it's not comfortable
with that. Bubbles, and we can see how easily they can form, where information is, it's being curated, it's just being kind of repeated and passed along among certain things. But smart networks almost work similar, like they are looking at patterns and habits. Do you think that those networks too could fall into a prey where they're not seeing some of the outlying things that could happen because they get themselves into
absolutely. Now, in smart networks where there's control and incentives and then there are players external to the networks that are trying to shape this type of network, there is an opportunity to create a bit of a structure of how, whether it's information or decisions are being formed. That is absent in a media network, right, where presumably there is no external powers that's controlling the flows and so forth. But in principle, yes, all of these can have their boundaries.
I'm going to open it up to the audience, but before we get there, I just wanted to share that we are kind of on our own network here too. First of all, you're watching this on YouTube, but at the same time, we are also doing a 360-degree video that you can watch on, if you go to www.visual-ex.com, you can watch it there, and you'll be able to see it in full 360. And the Visual X company, the Visual Experience company, is one of our house startups, and they do have these special glasses that you can put on, and if you watch the 360 using the glasses, it's even more cool. You feel like you are in part of this interview. So we'll take any questions from the audience?
Yeah, I'd like to start off by asking about, when you compare the different network systems that we rely on in daily life, whether it's financial, electric, logistics systems, internet nodes, whatever. Which of these is currently, do you think, at the greatest risk of systemic failure? And you can look at that from either the global level, perhaps, or perhaps just from a U.S. perspective.
That's a hard question for me to answer. Each one of them have a certain risk. Maybe the consequences for some are bigger than others. I mean, if you think about the financial network, the financial institution, if that fails, then everything cascades after that, because there's so much other dependent networks on the financial network. So if the financial network fails, then we right away start having investment problems, insurance problems, salary problems, job problems, and then the kind of falls apart. So in general, I would worry about that the most. I mean, the transportation network failing, I would talk a little bit about that in my talk. They can cause congestions for hours, maybe even days, but then people will recover. There, the recovery is much more complicated in getting back into it. So I would say, I think the financial network being the most, you know, the most, it's not that the most vulnerable, but the cost of vulnerability is the highest. It's a guess.
How much of a risk do automated trading systems and stock exchanges, how much does that multiply the risk?
It does. It does multiply the risk because it's vulnerable to a couple of things. One is hacking, but the other thing is also errors. So, you know, we saw that glitch that happened in the market where the 1 million became a billion, and then the markets collapsed, and then we had to shut down the stock market. So there you get into computational errors that could happen that are of some large magnitude. Also, I mean, a lot of these things, they have this local behavior of riding waves. So the computer. computer-generated investment strategies. Some of them are only searching for arbitrage, so they try to see small inefficiencies in the system for which they can take advantage of, so they buy and sell very quickly. And those also create instabilities in the market. As long as the market is doing well and it's going up, it's not a problem. But as the market starts fluctuating, these arbitrage actions increase the fluctuation. And increase the fluctuation, you start seeing more and more in the market. So it's not human, it's not eyeballing the data, it's really trying to detect these things in small variations. And they're definitely, I would say, at least they're more fragile.
So I don't know how to prioritize investment. People are always complaining that your opinion does not is always influenced by other factors. But especially with like Facebook and all of that. But realistically speaking, I don't know if there is a measure of how much people were influenced by this certain behavior before Twitter and Facebook and after. Because I feel like it's their anyways, maybe it's even better now. So I'm not sure if you're
I recently heard a talk about this, and there was an experiment that was, because we don't have the data from before, so we really don't have a network to compare to. So they've done this experiment in some parts of Africa where actually there's no internet penetration, and they found that in fact people create networks in our own way. It will be a lot slower, but there will always be a network, and there will always be dominant figures in these networks. And the dominant figures have the most effect on everybody else, and people through the word of mouth propagate this kind of domination. And so the argument that was made in that talk is that the shape of the network created manually looks a lot like the shape of the network that is from Facebook. So because the shapes of the networks are similar, you would imagine that the contagion or the herd phenomenon is similar. You gotta take that to the grain of salt, because you get millions of data points in the social network, and you get hundreds of data points in the actual experiment, and these are probabilistic analysis. But at some level, to some approximation, there's a lot of similarity. So the bottom line is this, right? Social networks are not random networks. They are random networks, but they're not arbitrary random networks. There's a distribution in them, right? And they have certain characteristics and properties that form, namely as I described, that are influential people and the people that have most followers. And these people, their action gets followed more than anybody else, and they are impactful in the network. And the evidence shows that type of network behavior existed before Twitter and Facebook, that this kind of influential structure. So it may be that it's very much similar, and this is a faster scale.
I have a question on this. Do you think, I totally agree that the herd phenomenon has always existed, but do you think that the way we consume knowledge now, because now it's everything is bite-sized, everything is small, it's consumable. Before you would watch maybe 30 minutes of news waiting for your segment to come on that you really wanted to hear, but you were somehow exposed to all this other stuff that you had to be patient and watch it all. And now you can just get the one little piece that you want. Do you think that's intensifying the herding experience?
Potentially. Even if you watch the 30 minutes, you can still be herding, right? It's just that the nature of the way we consume information, as you said, is different. I cannot really assess whether the impact on the herding is higher or smaller. All I can say is that it happens faster. We are able to access the information and then act on it, and then someone can see that and act on it in a much higher and faster time scale than the older time scale. But all of this stuff existed before. Now, when I say before, we didn't have the data, we didn't measure it, so we didn't really have a better, a good understanding of what these channels are and how they impact things, but in principle, I think they're probably, in terms of magnitude, they're probably as well. I don't know for sure.
Any other questions from the audience?
I throw one out about the wisdom of crowds. There's been a lot of analysis, and a lot of people have used crowds for predictive purposes, whether with events or crowdsource solutions to particular problems, that kind of thing. What is it about crowds and the crowd dynamic that works well in certain types of activities, but perhaps when you look at crowd preferences for things or political systems, why does it seem to go wrong?
That's a complicated question. I mean, fundamentally, the wisdom of crowds comes from the fact that you are averaging independent information. So as people have completely independent, the best set of crowds are ones that don't talk to each other. They all get their information from independent sources, and then you get that information and you average it, then you get the best information you want. So that's wisdom of the crowd, right? In mathematics, it's called the central limit. It basically says that if you have independent observations, you can run the underlying thing. The problem is, the more networked these people are, that what you hear from them is not independent, right? So what you hear from one person is impacted by the opinion of some other person that is impacted by the opinion of another person, and this cascade behavior is exactly why a lot of times herding is an example of aggregating information where the wisdom of the crowd is not sufficient to tell you what you want to learn. So herding is a place where, in a way, if you herd around the wrong decision, for example, then the crowd can help. So the more connected the crowds are, the more their information is dependent on each other, the less actually you get it, right, from each person, because you're maybe even hearing one person's opinion iterated multiple times. So I think that you can talk a little bit about the network aspect of how people are connected and say, look, and it depends on how the network is positioned and how people talk to each other and how much of the information I'm getting is dependent on itself. You can say something about how quickly you can run. But this is case by case.
Any other questions? Well, thank you so much for joining
thank
us
you.
Today. It's been a really interesting conversation, and I know you will be back at 5:30 with your keynote on a network of systems and society. So if those of you who are at CAUSE, please join us in the auditorium to watch him, or you can watch him live here on our YouTube channel or our Facebook page. And again, for those of you who are watching, and if you want a totally different experience, tune in, go to www.visual-.